Good evening, passengers, and welcome to tonight's episode of Trademark's Trainwreck, a show featured on Celestia Radio, all fandom all the time. With me here tonight is Random Greymane.
Blah, 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 blah.
Sherlock.
Yes, I'm here.
And the fangirl.
Yo.
So, how are we today, folks?
Oh, I found some fun news to talk about. Some amusing jokes.
Alright.
So, did you guys hear about this? Joe Exotic, the Tiger King, has just been sentenced to 21 years in prison.
Oh, yeah, I've heard about that one.
Yeah. Apparently the prosecutor says that anything that he was considered a public health risk, because if they didn't get him into jail, then we would have to suffer through a third season.
I'll do you one better. I've been poking at the news articles, and his sentence has been reduced by a whopping 1 year.
20 years. Good for him.
Oh, yeah.
Also, I heard about this. This is so stupid. So, okay, I'm going to talk about a couple of stupid people involving that also have to do with the human malware syndrome.
Yeah.
So Kid Rock has announced that he's not going to be playing at any venues that require vaccines or mask mandates. And I'm like, okay, yeah, sure. Go ahead and listen to the 50-year-old. Listen to a man. Listen, take science advice from a 51-year-old man that calls himself Kid.
All I can say is if it prevents him from playing, well, the mask mandates are working.
Yeah, exactly. I'm trying to remember her name. Yeah, Kellyanne Conway. Remember one of the... what was her even her title?
Oh, I don't remember.
she was basically one of the people that went on to Fox News and other news organizations that would be willing to listen to her and try and blow smoke up their ass for the giant orange Julius Caesar.
Mm-hmm.
And she's got a new book coming out. It's kind of a memoir thing. And you know how they all do this bullshit. It's called Here's the Deal, which coincidentally is also going to be the name of the bargain bin at the local bookstore you'll find her book in. Also, a little bit of sports news I found out about, and I'm getting sick and tired of hearing about this. Tom Brady's finally retiring.
Oh, God. Isn't this like the third time he's been retiring?
No, I think you're thinking of somebody else, but this is like... It's 22 years. It's 22 years with the NFL. And I'm just like, fuck's sake, dude. Most guys would have like gone. I mean, he's got plenty of trophies, but here's the thing, it really pisses me off with a lot of these sports fans is that they're like, oh, he's the greatest of all time. Tom Brady's the GOAT. I'm like, really? I mean, okay. How many teams did he get traded to, and did he ever actually make a field goal?
I don't know. I don't pay attention to sports
ball. I don't think so.
Not for 20 years, at least.
Yeah, not for 20 fucking years. I mean, the man like was riding on name recognition alone for a good chunk of this time. I mean, he's a good strategist. He knows how to run. He knows how to run as a quarterback. That's all. He's not really all that amazing.
Wait, I'm a geek. I'm not supposed to know about the sports ball.
I think the only thing I know about the sports ball is I think there was like Tom Brady's personal health advisor, health guru or some shit like that. And he had a habit of telling Tom Brady all of these snake oil salesman sort of things. Alex Guerrero, I think his name is.
Yes. I think so. He essentially was telling it, and all this crazy shit is actually really, really important, and you should listen to me, pal.
Yeah, he has a... He's a practitioner in alternative medicine.
Oh, so he's got a PhD in homeopathic medicine. Gotcha.
Yes.
It's like, okay, I listen to you.
I'm all for being that person that believes that there's medical things, okay, that are not done by the medical industry. I'm good with that because there are plenty of things that have been done over the past that turned out to be real remedies.
Of course. Okay? I mean, that's how science works. That's how we got here.
Right. That's how we got here. But the propensity now of data versus junk. Yeah, the signal to noise ratio has gotten really bad.
Fact versus feelings. Let's just call it what it is.
Yeah. There we go. Fact.
Let's use little Benny Shapiro's favorite term, facts versus feelings.
Yeah, because
it boils down to this, my friends. Yes, very much so. If you know your body well, then you need to listen to your body. If your body definitely is telling you, hey, I'm sick because I eat too much and it's not good for me. Or, hey, I'm sick because I'm not eating enough food and it's not good for me. Or, hey, I'm sick because something got inside me that doesn't need to be here. You need to fucking do something about it. Listen to your body. If you're hungry, eat. If you need if you want to eat something, like, if you feel like you, like, obviously not dirt, but like if you are suddenly for some strange reason craving dirt, that means you need some vegetables and minerals in your diet. Go eat some fucking lettuce.
Or you're a Republican anti-vaxxer.
If your body is telling you I am sick, do something about it. Get something that will make me feel better. Yes, go to a doc. That's when you listen to your brain and common sense and science and go to a doctor and say, hey, I'm sick. I think I need medicine. Tell me what's wrong with me so I can go get some medicine.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's when feeling is then translated into science.
Yeah. And God is forbid, though, everyone, if you are tired, sleep.
Yes, okay. If you are tired,
God,
sleep.
If you're tired, sleep.
Yes, for the love of God, sleep. Even if you think it's too much sleep, no, there's no such thing as too much sleep. Take it from
you.
Me.
Yeah,
sleep. Like your body requires a certain amount of sleep. If you're sleep
and it's different for everybody.
Exactly,
it is absolutely different for everybody.
If your body says, "Hey, I'm great. Let's get up and do stuff," after only 4.5 hours of sleep, good. That's what your body specifically needs to sleep until it changes and it's like, oh, I need an extra hour. Yeah. If your body needs 9 hours of sleep, listen to it and go to bed so you early enough to get those 9 hours. Just do what you got to do by listening to your body. And when your body requires the help of science, for the love of God, go find the science.
Also,
you know,
Go on, Greg.
Well, what I was gonna point out the fact that some of them won't even go to science, even if they're not feeling good.
No, of course not. Because
some of us can't go to science when we're not feeling good because we don't have money.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you, American medical system. Yes.
Thank you, American medical system.
That's why we have all these snake oil salesmen and miracle cure workers. And to briefly snatch a phrase from a podcast I highly recommend if you want to have a...
Is that Sawbones Buckhead?
Yes, it is Sawbones from Justin McElroy and his wife, Dr. Sydney McElroy. She is not a practitioner of medicine. She just has a degree, so she knows her shit.
She is a practitioner of medicine. She was a...
Well, she's not, like, out there in the field. But to steal their phrase real quick...
She's not actively practicing.
To steal their popular phrase real quick, what do we know about miracle cures?
They cure nothing!
They cure nothing. Zip. Zero. Nada. This can cure your cancer and also your toe jam.
No, it can't. It will not.
This will cure your hammer toe and your headache. No.
No, it won't. This will cure your depression and clear your skin. No, it fucking won't.
No, it won't. If it's too good to be true,
it is.
It is.
It most certainly is.
I mean, fuck. This feels like something that should be under the category of common sense, but even during the Divic 91 bullshit that we'd that we are still going through to some extent, we still had assholes that were doing all these, like, certain cures and shit. Like, we even covered a guy last year that was peddling bleach and saying, this'll cure it.
I personally know someone who down the daily takes, very regularly takes ivermectin and believes with all his heart and soul that it is keeping him from catching the Divic.
Yeah,
well, you know, what's his
gastric health like? He's probably shitting his brains out.
He's probably going to be shitting out his intestines.
His gastric health. He recently
shat his brain out.
No, as of a few days ago, he had to see a butt doctor.
What a shock! Oh, you know what? One of the other side effects of taking ivermectin on a regular basis is you go into impotent.
Ooh.
Yep. That's one of them. It kills
so,
all your...
You know, so you know what? Anyone out there who's listening, anybody that voted for Drumpf, and anyone who wears a red hat, and anyone who thinks that the vaccines do not work or wants to go maskless because it annoys them, please continue to take ivermectin. We want your genes out of the pool.
Please.
Well, I wasn't joking earlier. You do know that some of them are eating dirt, right?
Yeah, some of them are eating dirt. The people who have downed entire bottles of horse dewormer have literally shat out their intestines.
You can lead a horse to water. You can give them everything in the world. Like, there's boxes of free masks now, free masks from the government, N95 masks, no less. Okay, they're at my grocery store. I picked up the maximum limit of 3 per person, per visit.
My job lets us take masks for free within reason.
Right, but nobody, you know, there are people that are like, I don't need a free. It's free. I don't even want it if it's free. You know, it's like, really? Mm. Okay.
Well, getting off the Divic 91 train.
Yes, we probably should.
We should get moving along here because there's a gentleman who's probably anxiously waiting to watch the next episode of Boba Fett.
Fair enough. Well, considering fair enough.
As someone who
I haven't seen it yet, either, so.
as someone who watched it earlier due to weather issues requiring my store to close down early, it was very good. It was really, really good.
Well,
that's not a surprising, but anyway, we shall move forward.
Yeah, before we here on the train wreck watch Boba Fett off the air, it's time for our on-the-air shenanigans. You know it as well as I do, folks. We take a look at all the dumb news articles that I uncover over the course of a week or so, and we talk about some light material, and then we go into the heavy material, the softcore and the hardcore, ladies and gentlemen. And we have musical interludes somewhere in the middle, one of which is coming up right now. So we'll be right back with Trademark's Trainwreck, a show featured on Celestia Radio, all fandom all the time, except when it's going to the butt doctor. Welcome back, folks, to Trademark's Trainwreck, a show featured on Celestia Radio, all fandom, all the time. It's time to start the soft material, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank if you. We must.
Okay, so.
We must, unfortunately.
Let's start with a short and sweet one. You know, when your friend is in jail, and they have a bail that you can pay after scrounging up whatever funds you need to do so, that's a real nice move for you to do. However, methinks that you should use actual money and not bring drugs.
Oh, please. Please tell me this is the one I'm thinking of.
Well, let's find out if it's the one you're thinking of. We have an attempt to bail a friend out of jail which with counterfeit money, which led to a major drug bust in Auburn.
Auburn,
M-E.
Auburn, Maine.
M-E. Maine. Thank you, Greg.
Maine.
So, probably not the one you're thinking of, considering your reaction, Shirley.
But we've got quite a haul here, as you can see by the picture. But let's actually see what we've got here. Auburn police have arrested Angelina Quirion, 39, of Bangor, and Adam Jalbert, 33, of Caribou. Both have been charged with 4 counts of aggravated trafficking scheduled with drugs, Class A, and violation of conditional release, Class E. The Auburn Police Department was alerted of the pair when they attempted to bail someone out of the Androscoggin County Jail using counterfeit money. On January 20th, 2022, at 11:30 p.m., officers located Quirion and Jalbert waiting in a vehicle outside the jail. Both Quirion and Jalbert had active bail conditions from previous drug arrests. So I'm supposing that means they were bailed out of jail sometime before for drug-related charges. So when two people doing the same thing with their buddy over there just rolled up to jail, is just like, hang on. So officers searched their vehicle and located a large quantity of narcotics. And that includes 112.3 grams of cocaine base, 165.3 grams of just straight cocaine, 299.5 grams of fentanyl, 400
and getting all this fentanyl,
492.3 grams of methamphetamines,
meth,
along with a SCCY 9mm pistol. A Lewiston Police Department canine assisted in the search, probably the one time where the dog wasn't necessary, considering that this car was practically bursting to the seams with this stuff. What the fuck? Granted, I'm exaggerating, because the picture, of course, shows us little dime bags and baggies and stuff like that, so... But still, hitting the triple digits in terms of how much you got there. Holy shit. The investigation is ongoing. The Auburn police are working with other law enforcement agencies and anticipate additional charges being filed. Sherlock, your thoughts?
Well, I mean, this just seems kind of like, so they didn't bring it to the prison, did they?
They brought the counter. I think they had it in the car. But the thing is, the thing that tipped them off is they brought counterfeit money, which, as you'll note there, are $20 bills. You would think for a bail you would bring legitimate hundos out, and it's more difficult to fake $100 bills considering that blue strip that we America have.
No, it's not.
Oh, no, it's not. Of course you would be the dissenting voice, Greymane.
Well, here's the thing. Many countries laugh at our money.
Yes, they do.
Because it is easy to...
We are probably... this trademark is about to say something completely stupid. That's not true. We are probably one of the few countries that use paper money. Like, Australia has plastic money that they can put in the washing machine. It'll come out just fine. We're using paper money. Oh, no! I lost my 20!
No, there's many countries that still use paper money. The issue is that we don't use enough dyes, okay? We don't use enough colors.
We just stuck with green.
Right, we...
And plus, our money is technically a mixture of paper and cloth, so...
Correct.
It actually takes
a lot of effort to destroy a dollar bill in the wash.
Exactly, and on top of that, if you are careful enough with it, and this is how counterfeiters usually do this, they will... The most common counterfeit... And I say this working in retail and having checked for counterfeits because I know about this shit. This is how you find the counterfeit so you can catch them in the act. I'm doing this as a help aid, not to try and... I am not encouraged... We here at Celestia Radio do not encourage counterfeits.
The shoe is on the other foot!
I am giving you this advice so you know what to look for if you suspect someone has handed you funny money... And you do not have a counterfeit checking pen on hand. What usually happens is somebody will take a lower denomination bill, like a $1 bill or even a $5 bill, especially for the ones that have the special fibers in them. And in some rare cases, a 10, and they will wash the ink off of them and then reprint them using some at home, like these dipshits, they'll probably use like a home printer.
Uh-huh.
But for the ones that are really in it for the long haul, they'll have all the special inks that, yes, look and probably are, you know, government grade inks to try and replicate, like hundos and 50s. And but
the hundo is actually the most replicated U.S. bill.
No, obviously.
But here's the thing. Here's how you detect the fake. If it was made with a $1 bill, there will be no watermarks. Except there will be like, and no hidden presidential face picture hidden somewhere on it when you hold it up to the light. Okay. Whereas with fives, tens, twenties, fifties, and of course the $100, you can find the face of the president corresponding to it. So if you get a Benjamin, but Abe Lincoln's face is in the corner, you got an issue.
There's actually a hilarious thing I found out. It's a, kind of like this horrible little hack that the government really can't do much about unless they really look into it hard. But then that would involve like going to a bank and going through like literal tons of damaged bills to actually prove this.
Mm.
Banks are required to replace damaged money.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So, take a $100 bill, rip it in half, take one half to a bank, get it replaced. Take the other half to another bank on another day, get it replaced.
Yep.
Hmm. Oh.
Yep.
That's legit money.
Technically, you are able, as long as...
Technically, that's bank fraud.
Technically, it's bank fraud, but as if you are... If you have 50% or greater of the bill, okay, you can get it replaced.
Hmm.
All right, but yes, it is bank fraud, but it's one that they'd be unable to.
It'd be the hardest thing to prove because it'd be like you'd have to literally sift through tons of like shredded paper. Shredded bills to find the corresponding serial.
Yeah, you would have to reassemble all the shredded cash, and it's like, that's not some. There's a reason they put shredded cash in like pens.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Okay?
You know, because nobody's ever going to reassemble all that.
Well, but my point is, with because of my retail experience, when it comes to finding a counterfeit, sometimes. Our system is flawed, and in the past, the method I described of just washing off the ink used to be really hard to fucking pinpoint because of the whole watermark situation and the hidden face situation, but now because of the whole hidden portrait sitch, it's a lot easier to figure it out, but that's only half of the solution. The other half of the solution is you gotta have people who are actually looking at this money who will actually take time to look at the picture, because again, this is a method that bypasses the fake money pen. It bypasses some of the other issues where they're looking for the threads and the special fibers. Yeah, this is legit a point of you have to actually pick it up and look at it in the light.
Yep.
And it's not all cashiers, not all people in a store or even in a bank are always going to notice it first off or look at it first off to do this. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people do get away with counterfeit in this manner.
Yep.
But to have the audacity to do this out of jail?
Well, I mean, okay, so this could actually be a couple of charges. This could be either this could be contraband charges. They could actually bring up contraband charges against the person because there was large amounts of drugs in the car that came to the jail to, you know, drop off the counterfeit money. But I mean, here's the thing. The counterfeit money's a bigger deal because that is investigated by the Fed right away. Not just the Fed, the Secret Service, Treasury.
Yep. Exactly.
And the second they find out now, the Secret Service investigates every call of counterfeit money, which is why it's been so prevalent as Gray Mane has said, because our Secret Service have had their budget slashed for the past 4 years, probably longer. I don't think Obama, like, brought the budget back up. He sure as hell didn't bring it back up for the IRS.
The IRS has never had a proper budget, to be honest.
No, they need a proper budget. Anyway, but they investigate every claim, and they will charge you even for, like, one single $100 bill, yeah, counterfeit dollar bill. And if you don't report, if you notice it and don't report it, they will charge you. They're that serious about it. So when they have, like, when a local municipality or county calls the Secret Service, says, hey, we have, how much was the bail?
The article does not say, unfortunately.
Oh, we have, like, well, okay, I'll lowball it and say it was $2,500. If somebody says we have $2,500 in counterfeit 20s, the Secret Service is going to show up at that door real fucking fast.
Mm-hmm. Regardless, like I said, the investigation is ongoing, so maybe we'll see a sequel to this and see about those additional charges, if they stick.
But the federal charges will go first.
Oh, definitely.
That's just how it goes. But then once they've served their time, they'll be brought in on the county charges of drug possession.
Oh, yeah. Yep. They're going to get smacked real hard by the Fed. Anyway, next.
Smacked real hard.
Next disaster. Oh, God.
Yeah. You know, it's been a long time since I've been at the Golden Corral. I am very aware of what the Golden Corral is.
No.
I saw the video for this.
Yeah. The Golden Corral, for those
who don't know. The Golden Corral, the cafeteria for old people.
Pretty much.
It really is.
I've been there once or twice. It's okay. It's not amazing.
It used to be really good. It used to be fantastic because you would be able to get large quantities of decent food, okay, for not a lot of money. This has been a long time since it has been any sort of good.
Mm-hmm. So, and what did they fucking do at the Golden Corral?
Well, a brawl broke out over alleged steak shortage.
And what a shock. No one didn't get the red meat!
Yeah. There's a video, too, out there for it.
Oh, no! We got video!
There is indeed, and I've got a link. Now, let me just read while you guys potentially watch. This happened on February 1st, 2022, in Bensalem, Pennsylvania, I think? PA?
Yes.
More than 40 people may have been involved in a brawl at the Golden Corral in, yeah, there it is, Pennsylvania. The fight allegedly broke out after a customer became enraged when the buffet ran out of steak.
I want my steak.
Investigator.
I need meat! On top of meat! On top of meat!
Damn!
Yeah,
it's... Holy shit! Yeah. Children's seats flying!
Yeah.
Oh, God!
I want my Gofibi bowl.
Fucking... Oh, my God! They're just like... They brought out... It's like a wrestling match. They got the chair!
Yeah, it's wild. So, police confirmed the brawl may have involved more than 40 people and happened... reiterating the same point. They did not say what caused the argument, as that is still under investigation, but former employee Dylan Becker says he heard from his friend, a current employee at the Golden Corral location, that the fight started over steak. Quote from Becker, "There was two parties in line waiting for steak. Somebody had cut in front and then started being picky and finicky about the steaks and taking too long, and then somebody else spoke up and said something I guess the other party didn't like. Then it just looks like it turned into an all-out brawl." Another friend, Gavin Lauletta, heard the same details, adding that the restaurant allegedly ran out of steak, sparking the incident. Becker said his friend, the current Golden Corral employee, was hit by a table during the incident. "My friend, she's in the video trying to break it up, and she told me she got hit by a table and her ankle got bruised up pretty bad. And yeah, it's scary stuff. I've never seen nothing like that in Golden Corral before." JK Hospitality, LLC, the Golden Corral franchisee, wrote in a statement that no serious injuries have been reported. Police say the person or people who started the fight, once identified, could face assault charges.
So, yes, obviously.
Given that we have some differing variations of the story, here's what I'm going to surmise probably happened, because, again, I've worked in this field. What probably happened was that, as one party mentioned, yes, some people got in line for the steak, and somebody cut, and so words were exchanged, but they were all deciding, hey, we're not going to do this. We're in public. We're going to just shut up and wait our turns and get our food. But then the person in front, being picky, and a Karen or a Chad, like, gender is questioned here, but so I will use the neutral they. The entitled they at that moment just probably wasted the employee's time being very specific about which pieces of steak they wanted, how it was to be served, and how it was to be presented, to the point that the employee because of the Divic 91 mm-hmm. problem going on, still ongoing, probably had to get rid of the off cuts or the discarded cuts that the customer did not want, which then led to, of course, the sad and unfortunate "we are out of steak" comment, which then led the others in the line who had been wanting the steak and had to watch this unfold get angry and agitated, tell the customer who cut, hey, you fucked up. You made them waste food because you're so fucking picky. It's my food. Don't fucking come at me, bro. Well, I'm gonna come at you, and then tables and chairs start flying. That is at least what I think likely happened.
Sounds about right.
Another one of the things that's probably contributed to this is that restaurants, grocery stores, and hell, even hospitals, especially restaurants like the Golden Corral, you know, cafeteria style, are doing this kind of like money saving concept where I forgot what the actual term is called, but it's where they only stock the minimum supply and don't restock until they've run out.
Yeah, it's called
because that way it's like, oh, that saves on overhead a little bit, so we can put a few more dimes into our CEO's pockets.
Yeah, it the original term for that is just-in-time manufacturing.
Just-in-time, yeah, that's it. Just-in-time supplies.
And, yeah, just-in-time supplies, and it's been rife for years because it's supposedly it's an efficiency setting, and it's like, no.
Just-in-time supplying is what caused so many problems during the Divic 91 pandemic problems, when grocery stores were out of fucking supplies and hospitals were out of fucking PPP equipment. Because so many hospitals are now run as private corporations now instead of, you know, public, instead of public institutions.
Probably,
and likewise, and it's still going on, not just in places like obviously Golden Corral, but my local KFC, when a coworker of mine went to get food, the local KFC apparently had run out of the chicken sandwiches. it's like, you're a Kentucky Fried Chicken. How can you now be out of chicken?
Yeah, it's even worse nowadays because of like supply chain issues and whatnot. Hell, I even work in the food industry at the time of this recording, and there have been times where we just straight run out of stuff and I just have to make do with what we got. And hell, it's not even a guarantee that when we are restocked, we get everything that we need. Sometimes we're shortchanged. Probably because someone else got first dibs on said product. It's just like,
you know, it's times like when I talk about and hear about things like this, it just reminds me of a song from Green Day back in the 90s.
Uh-huh. Oh.
Idiot America.
Oh.
There we go.
Or isn't that American Idiot?
American Idiot, yeah.
American Idiot.
Yeah.
I'm not going to speak to the supply chain issues because I could rant for hours about it. And a great amount of the supply chain issues are artificial.
I can believe
they're artificial for different reasons, not the least of which is people are tired of working for shit money for shit jobs. Yep. Okay. And people don't want to do that anymore, so therefore they like resigned in droves. And, you know, well, hey, you know, where's garbage guy that cleans up our streets. Well, he resigned because he didn't want to, you know, get paid $3 an hour to clean up after everybody's shit.
No, was really sad though. That garbage man probably still gets paid better than the average elementary school teacher.
Yeah. Yep.
Absolutely. So, yeah, it's I could rant for hours on it, but I'm not going to.
Yes, let us move on, because this is let's just leave it at this, guys. Don't start a fight in the restaurant because they're out of steak. For fuck's sake, get chicken.
If there's not enough food at the fucking cheap ass buffet, go to the McDonald's down the street.
Yeah. Also, I don't know if you know this, but a buffet has a plethora of options for you.
Yeah, you could eat something else.
You can have more than steak.
Get chicken. Chicken's very good.
Yeah.
Yes, chicken I would recommend. Salad I would not, for the simple reason that there has been a bad track record of really tainted salad in the U.S.
Golden Corral. Yeah.
At Golden Corral and in a lot of other places. So.
Yeah. Well.
Moving right along
to our final softcore article for the night. You know, you can get a lot of things at the Walmart. You can get so many things at the Walmart here in America. Hell, once upon a time, you could get guns and ammo.
You could still get guns and ammo at some Walmarts.
Yeah, but it's more regulated these days. But we're not talking about that. No, we're talking about one of the few things that you can't get in a Walmart, and that being a toddler.
I mean, thank God.
I'm confused now.
January 26, 2022. Texas woman offers Walmart
2021,
shop.
Sir.
No, it's 2022.
I'm stupid. Never mind. My brain. I'm still in January mode.
Oh, you just gave me a fucking brain fart. Okay. I will debate whether or not to cut that out. I'll probably leave it in for the lulls. Anyway, Texas woman offers Walmart shopper $500,000 to buy her toddler.
Why are you going to the fucking Walmart? If you got that kind of money, go to an adoption agency. Fuck's sake.
Okay, so...
Or give it to a lady and say, hey, can you carry a baby for me for a few months? And then when you pop it out, give it to me. You know, they make... Surrogates live for that.
Yeah, but let's...
For that very reason.
Let's instead see what this woman in Crockett, Texas did.
Crockett?
Because of course it's Texas.
Yeah. A Texas woman was arrested recently after police said she approached another woman in a Walmart store and offered her hundreds of thousands of dollars to buy her one-year-old child. Rebecca L. Taylor, 49, was arrested the previous week, the week prior to January 26, 2022. She was arrested and charged with sale or purchase of a child, a third-degree felony. The charge was filed after Taylor approached a mother and her two young children in the store's self-checkout lanes and offered the other woman money to purchase her one-year-old child. Taylor noted the child's blonde hair and blue eyes, and asked how much she could purchase him for.
Oh, God.
Taylor then told the mother she had $250,000 in her car and that he was the perfect fit, and she had been wanting to buy a baby for a long time now. That's a quote from the affidavit.
One, creepy as fuck. Yeah. Two, again, $250,000, just hire a woman to carry your baby for you. Make sure that money goes towards her well-being, her feeding, her health care. And shit, and then after she has the baby for you, say thank you very much for helping me achieve the wonder and beauty of motherhood, because I am incapable of doing it. Not, and you have given me the perfect child for my dark ritual.
He gets...
Hey, knock it off, that's the wrong podcast.
That's an inside joke if that never sees the light of day. Taylor reportedly was with a second woman. The mother waited for the two women to leave Walmart before heading to her car. Taylor found her in the parking lot, however, and began screaming at the mother, saying if she wouldn't take $250,000 for him, then she would give her twice that much because she wanted him and she was going to take him. Ugh.
Again.
I actually don't think. Okay.
This is point, okay. Okay. I mean, I hate.
One at a time, Fanny first.
This is verging into not appropriate for this podcast territory, but this is giving me this is giving me flashbacks to the various true crime stories of women who literally attacked pregnant moms and stolen their babies from the womb.
Yeah, this
because they're so delusional.
Those have been cases, yes.
Yeah,
because they're so delusional and crazy that they're willing to do that in order to, you know, live out their "I want a baby" moment.
It's like a less whimsical version of Tokyo Godfathers.
That whimsical, man. That was still fucked up.
Oh yeah, it was. But there was enough bullshit in that movie to make it somewhat whimsical. It was still fucked up, but yeah.
But no. Yeah, this is fucked up. Like, no, you are not buying the baby. And no, they're not going to let you take the baby. In fact, here, talk to the cops. The cops will tell you aren't taking that baby.
Yeah, talk to the cops who are going to look at that surveillance footage and see that, you know, the mother's story is fully corroborated by that. And also, you could face 2 years in jail in a with 2 years minimum in jail and a maximum of 10 years, as well as a $10,000 penalty.
She's got $500,000 to blow. I mean, what's 10 grand?
If she's got $500,000 to blow for a baby, I guess she probably then let's hope that the judge decides to put more money than she has to keep her out of off the fucking street.
Yeah,
sadly, not allowed to do that. I wish that were an option where you were able to like charge them based on their income rather than, you know, just a flat fee. Because then we could actually put some rich people behind bars for proper.
But
surely,
I will admit that I thought this story was going to go the other way. Okay, where it was the mom going, "Take my kid," and I'm like, "That's every parent with a toddler ever."
Here, take my kid. I'll pay you thousands of dollars.
I will pay you thousands of dollars to take my kid.
like, thankfully, not.
No, at that point, like, why aren't you taking them to? Like, why aren't you taking them to a daycare?
Yeah, exactly.
Because daycares aren't free in the United States.
Yeah, and I don't know if you remember this from the days before YouTube. We've seen some daycares that are pretty fucked.
Yeah, yes, this is true.
Absolutely. But no, what are you doing, lady? I mean,
yeah,
really?
What the fuck?
What the fuck?
Like this is again also giving me flashbacks of horror stories of I went to the grocery store and I turned around for just a second and then some lady just grabbed my baby and started walking away and then she started screaming that I was trying to kidnap her child and people were listening to her instead of me even though I literally look like my child.
Yeah, this is some shit that you would hear from like the No Sleep podcast, regardless of
and
whether
the Let's Not Meet or the Let's Not Meet portion of Reddit.
Yeah, just ugh.
Like, oh god, things that make you go.
Shirley, you wanted to make a point earlier.
I was just gonna say that the way that this woman was starting to react, I'm just going to hazard a guess here, just a shot in the dark. I don't think she had $500,000 on her.
I don't think so either.
Yeah, I'm gonna say no.
Nobody rolls around with $250,000 in the car.
Or $500,000 in their fucking trunk.
Yeah, no, this woman didn't have money. She wasn't going to pay. Not at all.
I will say that this woman probably didn't have the money, but there are people that roll around with that much in their vehicles. Years and years and years ago, I worked for a basement computer company. One of our clients, okay, he would always order the best computers, everything, and he'd pay up front and everything else. And I'm like, so I asked my boss, I'm like, what does he do? He sells gold. I'm like, okay, what does he sell? He sells gold stock or something? No. Have you ever looked at the back of his car? I'm like, why? Well, you know how it sits lower like that? Yeah, he's got like a giant safe in the back of his car that he sells gold out of. And I'm like, you're shitting me. And I asked the guy and he's like, oh yeah, do you want to see the safe? No, that's okay. I don't need to see the safe. But you know, it's like, well, that's okay, fine. And sure enough, he had stories like people would like strip his car because he parked it in the wrong neighborhood. Okay, but they'd leave the safe. You know?
Because they probably couldn't get it out.
Yeah,
they probably,
jokes they, on they you, suckers.
Yeah, you know, but it's like, it had like, you know, thousands of dollars of gold in the safe, and it's like, oh, okay.
Not gonna lie, when you said, oh, you notice how that car just kind of leans down in the back? I thought you were just gonna say, oh yeah, he's got all these gold bars in the trunk. Not even a safe, just, the trunk's just lined with gold bars.
It was pretty close.
It's like
it was
Marcellus close. Wallace's fucking trunk.
Just have that same, just have the moment of like, we're going to open the fucking magic glowing suitcase.
Yeah,
there you go.
So I gotta ask, Gray, was this guy like one of those cash for gold scam artists?
No, literally, it's hard to explain because some of the people that I knew, okay, were actually really, really fucking rich people, and they would be liquidating some of their gold. Okay?
Probably because this actually happened in the early 2000s, and early 2000s where the cost of silver, because like,
yeah, this was well before that. Okay.
Yeah, but like there's points in history where the cost of precious metals became so worthless that the cost of storing it wasn't worth the poundage. I remember that happened, like silver dipped so hard in the early 2000s that it wasn't worth the amount of effort to store it in a bank vault.
Yep.
So,
but yeah, this guy
started getting sold left and right.
And yeah, this guy would just he would just do, you know, physical gold transactions and give them cash, and he always had like a ton of cash on him. And he always had a ton of gold in the trunk. It was big old boat because nothing else would.
Nothing else would do it.
Nothing else would carry that load around in the trunk.
But yeah, to bring it on back home, fuck this lady.
Fuck this lady. Fuck this and her creepy child trunk. Oh, true. But instead of fuck this lady, then let's just say this lady can go straight to hell with her crazy baby trafficking.
Go directly to jail. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Do not collect $250,000. Well, on that note, it's time for our second musical interlude for the evening. We'll be right back with the Hardcore Material on Trademark's Trainwreck, a show featured on Celestia Radio. All Phantom all the time, except when you don't collect a baby.
There's gold in that trunk. Banana Daiquiris.
Welcome back to Trademark's Trainwreck, a show featured on Celestia Radio, all Phantom all the time. It's time to start the Hardcore Material. So, fundraisers. Nowadays, they are very rampant and they cover a wide variety of expenses, ranging from the entertainment industry, see the Legend of Vox Machina, and also the SWAT Cats revival that's going on.
They're trying that again?
Oh yeah, they are. They just had trouble finding company to use as a platform to launch it from.
I know they attempted because 10 like donated to it, but it failed.
No, it didn't. It made the gold the day after. At least that's what one of my sources are saying.
Yeah, this isn't the first time this has been tried. So
okay.
No, like the original attempt.
Well, either way, staying on track. There's also all the more selfish sort of things. It's just like, pay for my trip to Hawaii, you know, that sort
pay for
of,
my sort of shit. Pay for my magnificent wedding.
Yeah, that you know, sort of shit.
You're not invited to my awesome wedding, but pay for it anyway.
What was the one guy? The one guy was like, "Oh, I'm gonna sell this potato salad."
What?
Yeah, I'll have to look it up for you later. It's, he's like, I want to sell this potato salad, and, how much will you give me for this potato salad? And it was on Kickstarter, okay? And, you know, it's an awesome bowl of potato salad. You have 3 or 4 days, because otherwise it'll go bad. And he literally, I think he made like $10,000 on fucking Kickstarter because of a bowl of potato salad.
But yeah.
Yeah, it's actually true. And, you know, a lot of people gave him flack for it, but it's hilarious. And before you get too trade, I do want to say my favorite of all time.
Oh, yeah.
Fundraiser scam that ended so many idiots' lives, financial lives anyway, and also got the guy sued and investigated by the Treasury Department.
Oh, Treasury. Yeah. What was it?
It was the guy who was doing a Kickstarter campaign to build Donald Trump's wall.
Yes. I remember that. Yep.
Well, the less said about that, the better. This article here is less about Kickstarter or fundraiser scams and more like a quote-unquote ill-advised fundraiser. So, there is a soccer club in Sacramento. And apparently, their idea of a fundraiser is to sell sex toys.
Oh, boy! I heard about this.
Well,
what did this?
Well, this was posted January 28th, 2022, Sacramento, California. Natomas Football Academy, a soccer club with an extensive youth program, launched a fundraiser that week that included the sale of adult toys and sexually themed products. Natomas FA fundraiser was promoted on the club's Facebook page and sent via email blast to over 1,000 parents and adults in the club. After parents raised concerns and KCRA3, oh, that's probably the news. Yeah, that's the news I'm not reading this from. Feature Trade, edit that out, please. After parents raised concerns and started asking questions about the fundraiser, club leadership said they made the decision to pull down the fundraiser links in order to appease anyone who might have been upset by that. If there's a backlash with this and people are usually unhappy about it, then we'll not do it again, Natomas FA Leadership Secretary Wendy Hill said. The controversy started with an announcement to the club's listserv subscribers and Facebook followers. A post that has since been removed from Natomas FA's Facebook page read, "Less than 3 weeks until Valentine's Day. Support Natomas Football Academy by purchasing your C's candy and pure romance gifts here." I want to point out, C's candy is not the issue here. It's pure romance. C's candy is just like caramel and shit.
It's also like chocolate-coated hard candy, peppermint usually.
Yeah, C's candy is not the company we're taking a look at. It's pure romance. "Each fundraiser that we do keeps us working towards our goal of keeping our fees low so everyone plays soccer. This is supposed to help bring in some money," Hill said. "Some parents are choosing to turn it into something horrible." Now, here's the thing. That's a direct quote from the video, and that video also shows that while, yes, that site is, as Wendy Hill says, a health and wellness company, you know, there's stuff on there like lotions or whatever, like non-sexual stuff. But as she says, there are also education and products that help people from the moment that they wake up in the morning until they fall asleep at night. Hint, hint. Because, yes, alongside all of the non-sexually themed products there are also a lot of other sexually themed products. You know, adult toys and a host of other sexually themed products. And, you know, that's not the kind of thing you want associated with a youth program, indirectly or no. So
I think this was somebody's just massive fucking...
fuck-up.
Okay, yeah. You know what? Surprise, surprise, I'm going to be the dissenting voice here. I'm all for this. Okay?
Go
One,
on.
All right. One, we should not be hiding certain things of sexuality. Okay?
That I do agree with.
I agree with that, yes.
We should not be afraid of the dildo. Okay? I'm sorry. We shouldn't.
No, of course not.
We shouldn't be squeamish about this. Okay? Second, this appears to be a youth program that's outside of a school. Do we know for sure?
It's a football academy, so...
Right. If it's an independent company, you know what? More power to them. Okay? But honestly, this sort of stuff should be out in the open. Okay? You should be able to walk down the aisle at your local big box store and go, oh, that's a dildo. It's on special. You know? And put it in the cart. Okay?
One
at a time.
If we're gonna go with the fact that it is a use thing, okay, and it is a third party, okay, that parents pay for, there has to be a certain age limit as far as this is concerned, though. All right.
Yeah.
We are so stuck up about sex in the U.S. It's not funny. Okay. You know, we teach our kids the wrong thing because we don't want to have a real conversation about it. Okay, and that's one of my biggest pet peeves about this stuff, okay, is because you cause more problems by teaching them the wrong thing than you do. You put them more at risk by teaching them the wrong thing than you do by teaching them the right stuff. All right. Now, that said, yes, there is an age limit thing, okay? If the younger kids were not involved in this sale, okay, like maybe they were selling the candy, all right? And the older kids were selling the other stuff, that's okay to me, okay? Because there's a separation. But if you got a like a 6-year-old soccer kid handing out a dildo, no, that's not why you.
Yeah, it's a coupon or a gift card.
It is a coupon for the website. Yes, and
well, there
and
you go.
Parents,
okay,
of course, went on the website and saw what was happening. It's just like, excuse me, but. Before we continue, I think Fanny had a point that she wanted to bring up as well.
Yes, Fanny had points. I'm sorry, Fanny.
I had some points. One, I was going to say, but you kind of brought up the things that I wanted to say anyway, because you went and stated what I was going to say. When it comes to, like, the older youth, like the ones who are 18, at least in my opinion, maybe 17 for the educational purposes, because... As someone who was an educator once, I agree. We are a bit too squeamish when we're teaching children sex education. It is unfair to only teach either sex is only good for marriage or abstain for the rest of your life, because kids are, like, I hate to admit, no one likes to talk about this reality, but kids are going to be curious. They have always been curious, and they're going to want to know more, especially as their bodies develop and they grow.
Well, we're hardwired for sex.
This is just, we are primates, and we, like other primates, are going to eventually discover it. But my point is, there are certain levels of appropriateness for the age group. When it comes to teaching the early stages of teaching this, for the kids who are younger, like, you know, your 13-year-olds who are going through natural changes, like hair in places where there was no hair before, and strange cravings for strange foods, you know, kids in that age bracket, yeah. Teach them about how their body is changing, what they will eventually start developing, and that eventually they're going to want to explore these avenues, and how to do it safely when they are of age, like birth control, condoms, medicines, teach the girls that they are going to need pads and tampons to staunch that horrible, horrible thing known as Tom. Please do. Teach the girls that they are going to turn into werewolves and that they need to be able to control the beast within.
Oh,
like,
God.
Teach the boys that though they may like to touch the girl bottom, it is inappropriate to touch their bottom without somebody's consent.
Yes.
You know? Like, teach these things, teach safety, teach common sense, do this when they're in that age bracket, so that they have a good foundation. And then when they're older, when, like, in their older teens, especially when they're 18, then say, all right, let's talk about dildos and butt plugs.
Yeah, now, all that being said,
yeah, I agree with Greymane. There should be age brackets, and I hope that's what they had originally intended and what was attempted. But parents, of course, went, oh my god, and clutched their pearls.
Yeah. Well,
I sincerely, deeply hope that it was not, okay, boys and girls of all ages and all sizes, let's sell some sex toys along with those heart-shaped chocolate bars.
Whee! But, you know, looking at the photo, obviously if it's a gift card that is like a coupon, okay?
Yeah, it's an online gift card. It's just,
nobody cares because it's you know, you're going to use it for whatever's on the website.
Exactly, you're going to use it.
The only reason this garnered so much attention was because it was a fundraiser
associated with a youth group.
It's associated with a youth group. The minute that you associate children with sex beyond an educational format, parents
even with an educational
parents get very squeamish, and I agree with
parents that are going to clutch moms are going to clutch their pearls, and dads are going to go burr, 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 burr,
yeah
burr, burr.
And I agree with everything that's been said here. Children should be taught about that shit in an educational sense, you know, so we don't have a lot of fuck-ups going on. But but the problem is, like, again, it's that association. Like, I feel like this was not really thought out through. I feel like someone just brought up, hey, should we use this website as a platform for a fundraiser? Yeah, sure, fuck it.
Well, here's my thing. The website would, the company actually had to agree to this.
And I'm sure the company agreed to, again,
Yeah, they didn't know what they were getting into. They was like, wait, this is for kids?
Like, some guy, one of the mentors or runners or whatever of this facility probably went up to them and said, hey, my group, they probably didn't even realize that it was a football group for kids. They probably thought it was like a grown-ups or an adults football league. And they're like, hey, my football league wants to do a fundraiser for our teams. Would you like to partner with us? Oh, that sounds like a wonderful idea. And then later on learn, wait, you mean this is a kids football team?
This is a football academy with a youth program? Shit.
We were not made aware of this information beginning.
Bob, yeah, take the mini dildos off of the coupons.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're sending just the coupons.
Just oh god, Greymane.
We're sending just the coupons.
To kind of go along with the whole we have a terrible, absolutely terrible sex education system in the United States. I'm like, I totally agree. I actually had one of the best sex educations compared to most of you guys, from what I remember hearing.
Mm-hmm. What was her name?
Huh?
Nothing. Never mind.
Jesus.
And even I was like, they started us in the fifth grade, and it was every other year until we graduated senior year. And it was kind of like, even then I was like, well, I didn't learn everything, obviously, but it was also, I'm a product of the time. Like, they didn't know everything.
Mm-hmm.
They knew a lot of clinical stuff. They basically knew about the concepts of homosexuality, which they brought up in junior high, and they basically had to default say there's nothing wrong with it.
I was during the period when they first introduced sex education in schools. Okay.
Yeah.
And
I grew up in the Bible Belt where it was abstinence or only when you get married.
Yeah.
It was for us, when I was going to school in the 70s, it was clinical. It was completely clinical. There was nothing about emotions. There was nothing about a safe sex, because that was, you know, that you didn't even talk about that, which is funny because the 70s came after the 60s, you know, and there were still a lot of people having, you know, having orgies, literally. And, you know, they were so afraid of touching it that they made the school principal conduct the class, not the teachers. And it was just an insane, you know, badly taught clinical class with nothing. And if you ask the wrong question, go ask your parents. And your parents, of course, wouldn't answer because, you know, we're totally screwed on sex. And I'll be quite blunt. I feel that the problem that we have sex in this country is due to religion. Okay? In the biggest part. That's where our problems with sex in this country come from, is due to
thank you, Mr. Kellogg.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Mr. Kellogg. Yes, the insane person who invented cornflakes. There's a whole story about him. Yeah, go look him up.
Again, go listen to Sawbones with Justin McElroy and his wife, Dr. Sydney McElroy.
I also suggest a biography by our Biographics channel by Simon Whistler on YouTube. He has a Kellogg's video.
Yeah, but let's bring it on back. Let's bring it on home and just emphasize that point. The point that
bring it in. Your
kids should be educated on sex in an educational format, and they should actually be taught what's going on. As for this fundraiser, methinks it was poorly thought through, but there was good intentions behind it.
You know, I have zero problem with a coupon.
Yeah.
None. Okay? You know, and if the parents find something on the website that is adult, well, the coupons aren't being sold to kids, last I checked.
Should be.
So, shouldn't be. So, what's the issue? You know? Mm. It's all pearl clutching, and I have a problem with that.
Yeah. Well, let's move on to some fun time. Let's go down to Florida.
Of course it's Florida.
Let's go down to Florida.
Florida man, what'd you do today, Florida man?
Had a bag of syringes and said that it was just for fishing. I love those sing-along moments. I love it. It's the only time I can get away with singing off-key.
Well, okay, so give us some context here, Trade.
Right, this is a drug suspect who was found with fentanyl in a bag of hypodermic needles. He told Florida police that he used the syringes for fishing. I want you to have that mental picture in your head. Some guy with a fucking fishing pole, and on the end of the line, not a worm, not a bit of hot dog, not a bit of lunch meat, not even like fucking bread or whatever you use for bait for the fish. No, it's a fucking syringe.
I'm just helping the fish shoot up.
Okay. Yeah. He's shooting. He's trying for junky fish.
Junky fish. You know what? Okay, hang on. I actually got... This is so funny because there was an episode of King of the Hill about this.
Let me guess. It was Dale.
Of course there was.
Hank was... insisting that, you know, good old, hang on, let me try my Hank impression, good old fashioned American dug worms are the only good bait you need, and all of his friends were using, like, this special scented bait and other things like this, but Hank wasn't able to catch anything because, well, it's kind of a myth that fish go after worms.
Yeah.
Unless they're, like, bottom feeders like catfish or something, most fish don't really give a fuck about worms. Hank's an idiot in a lot of ways like that.
That's
so,
an understatement.
So, Hank decides that he's just going to go ahead and, like, try some new bait, and he gets a word that there's this guy who is an expert on fishing, but he kind of didn't go to school. He works out of his truck, and he finds out where he needs to go and meet him, but he doesn't meet the guy who has the bait shop out of his truck. He meets a guy who is essentially a fucking drug runner or like a drug dealer who's selling crack out of his car.
Oh my God.
Hank gets this little block of crack and he ties it onto the end of his fishing hook and he starts like reeling in a really big fish. And he and Dale and everybody else just think, this is awesome. Look at all these fish. It's great. And then when they get busted because the fish that they're fishing in the pond, like, start to become used to the crack. So they don't want to, like, you know, they're like, well, we want something stronger, man. We've kind of gotten used to this stuff. So he goes to the same dealer to try and get some stronger baked, and I'm using a heavy air quote, and they all get, and he and Dale get busted by the cops during a drug sting operation. And he tries to plead his case to the judge. He's like, I thought I was buying fishing bait.
So fucking stupid. I can't guarantee that it's the same story here. I think this is just a case of, it's bait, officers. Let's see. Police responding to a 911 call on the week of January 25th, 2022. They got a call about a suspicious person. They encountered Eric Bennett, 30, on Avero Beach Street. An officer described Bennett as visibly intoxicated on an unknown substance.
Asked, I wonder what it could be.
Well, yeah. Well, let's check these large bulges in the pockets of his shorts. That wasn't needed. Bennett just straight up replied when questioned about them, I have hypodermic needles for fishing. He then removed a plastic bag with syringes inside from a pocket and placed the works on the hood of a squad car. Wow. Okay.
I think he was trying to avoid the situation ahead of time.
Yeah, but here's the thing. He also handed over a cigarette pack containing a baggie of fentanyl. And he said, I don't want to go to jail. Apparently,
too late for that.
Also, his occupation.
Well, this was counterintuitive to your wishes and desires.
Yeah. Also, I don't know why this is listed, but his occupation is listed as landscaping in court records. Maybe that'll explain his payload there.
Well, I mean, drug addicts and even drug dealers have, like, most of the time, drug dealing is a side job for some, is a side hustle for some people.
Hmm. The Vero Beach resident was arrested on a felony narcotics possession charge and booked into the county jail, where he's being held in lieu of $7,500 bond. Bennett, who is scheduled to be arraigned on February 25th, has prior convictions for grand theft, DUI, driving without a license, possession of drug paraphernalia, and probation violation. When arrested on January 22nd, it should be noted that Bennett was not carrying any fishing equipment, nor did he expound on his purported use of tiny spears to impale a big catch. Yeah, that's kind of the thing. If you don't have a fishing pole or something else, and you say, I've got syringes for fishing,
you're... If you're gonna do it, at least make it believable!
Dedicate to the bit.
Dedicate to the bit, yes.
Hey, officers, I got these hypodermic needles for fishing. You want to watch me cast a line out? Like, it really works, I swear. They'll just jump at the chance to have these things in their veins.
Again, it's the King of the Hill plot. That literally happened in the cartoon, like in the TV show. Eventually, to clear their names, Hank and his buddies had to go fishing and show the cops that, yes, this is what we thought it was doing. And sure enough, like, even, and they were scared because the fish had developed essentially an immunity to it. They were no longer interested in this shit, and so, like, they were absolutely certain that they were about to get fucking arrested.
Hank decided to do something. He decided to, like, use a worm, because he still had his bait bucket, still had live worms in it for some reason, amazingly. And he decided to use a worm behind the back of the cops and the judge, and he caught a little fish. And the judge is like, well, okay, I'll go with it.
You know what? I will give full credit where credit is due. That is the first and only time I've ever laughed at King of the Hill.
That is, oh, come on. King of the Hill actually has some moments where you laugh. They actually do some funny moments. Come on.
I know. I think I was too young to have watched King of the Hill back then. I just couldn't stand most of the characters, honestly.
Well, to be fair, there are some that do drive you fucking nuts, like Peggy.
Yeah, I fucking hate Peggy Hill.
No hate to Kathy Najimy, who does the voice of Peggy Hill.
No, of
Kathy
course not. That's,
she does a great job, because you can't stand the woman.
Yeah, like, it's just
Kathy
the way
is
the
a
character
marvelous
is
comedian. It's just
the
honey,
way
you made a character that everybody loved for it.
Yeah, like, I cannot stand the character. That is not the fault of the voice actor. That is the fault of, you know, the people that
made it. The writing.
Yeah, it's the writing.
You're not supposed to like Peggy. She's kind of an insufferable bitch.
Yeah, pretty much.
But anyway.
Oh, man.
Oh. I didn't like King of the Hill because I grew up with people like that. Yeah.
Speaking.
So did I. You remember I spent the first, like, few years of my life in Texas. I still have family there.
I'm sorry.
Speaking of insufferable bitches, though, we have one final article, and oh boy, prepare to be angry. Prepare to be very fucking angry.
Oh, no. Better get a shot.
This kind of goes back to our conversation about teaching our kids sex and the consequences of, you know, doing it when you're not prepared and all that shit, because, you know, I cannot guarantee that this woman didn't have that kind of education, you know, where it's just like, sex, you'll learn when you're older. But, you know, given what this woman did, methinks that that's not far off. So, woman flew to Florida, left kids home alone.
How old are the kids?
9 and 11.
11-year-old.
Too young.
Too young.
Too young.
The 11, I hate to say it, but I personally think the 11-year-old actually could be, just depending on their maturity level, could be just old enough to be able to do, to take care of them, take care of the two of them.
Well, here's the thing.
I was latchkey at 11, so I understand.
Here's the thing. There's more. I'm going to tell you.
But wait, there's more.
I'm going to tell you this story, and I will tell you, I read this in advance. I read it. Nobody got hurt. In fact, I'm going to double check right now to make sure that nobody got hurt and all that shit. Let's see. Nobody got hurt as far as I know. As far as this article tells me, nobody got hurt. But, well, here we go. This happened January 20th. A Connecticut teacher left her two children at home alone while she vacationed with her boyfriend in Florida. This is according to investigators who say the woman told the minors to stay out of sight in the basement and just eat candy for dinner.
What? Okay.
Now all the previous assumptions are gone. That's neglect. The fuck is wrong with you?
Yeah. And just like that,
vacation.
Just like that, I have done a magic trick. I had made all of the benefit of the doubt for this woman disappear.
Oh,
I'm
man.
A fucking wizard.
That's really, woman?
Carrie Kaviaska, 36, was arrested that Saturday on reckless endangerment and risk of injury charges in connection with her 3-day trip to the Sunshine State in late November. Kaviaska is free on $5,000 bond in advance of a January 25th Superior Court hearing, which, at the time of this recording, obviously, has already passed.
Wait a minute, how did she afford $5,000 on a teacher's salary with two kids?
I was just about to ask the same thing.
I don't know.
She's probably dealing fishing bait.
But,
Police began investigating Kaviaska after her ex-husband reported that she had left the children, ages 9 and 10, alone in a Watertown residence. Kaviaska, who has primary custody of the boy and girl, which therefore explains
not
why the husband
anymore.
Couldn't intervene.
Not anymore!
Yeah, not any fucking more. She's a middle school teacher in the Waterbury School District. As detailed in a...
Not anymore!
Yeah, not any fucking more. She's not. As detailed in an arrest affidavit, Kaviaska's former spouse provided cops with a series of incriminating texts she exchanged with her children while she was out of town. Both of you stay in the basement, wrote Kaviaska, who advised the children to avoid the upstairs of the residence and just staying downstairs. When one child asked, "Are we going to school?" "No, right?" Kaviaska replied, "No." on a Sunday evening when one of the children asked, "What are we going to have for dinner?" Kaviaska answered, "Just eat candy, I'm sorry, and whatever is downstairs." She added, "I'll make it up to you."
Oh boy. These kids.
So much wrong here.
It gets better. And by better, I mean worse.
Oh god.
Kaviaska Cup's charge wanted the children to stay out of sight in the basement. When one of the miners asked, "Can I pee?" Kaviaska replied, "Quick, no lights." After one of the children wrote, "I'm sad, I put my batteries upstairs," Kaviaska suggested that the child could go upstairs super fast, but noted, "Stay low so no one sees you."
Again, here's the thing.
Metal Gear Toddler.
Here's the thing. Here's the problem. Here's the thing. This woman is a moron because, again, she didn't have to do this. She truly did not have to do this.
No.
She has had an 11-year-old. And now, I don't know about the maturity of said 11-year-old, but she could have told the 11-year-old, "Hey, this is your chance to shine. Here is a copy of the house key. Here, I bought groceries for you guys. Here is a copy of the house key for you guys. I have you already on the next school bus. Here is your school bus number."
Yeah.
"You're going to get on the, you and your sibling are getting on the school bus after school every day. You will be coming home and unlocking the door. And there's enough food in the fridge. They're all microwave meals. Put them in the microwave, set it to this, you will be fine, we will come back from our vacation, don't open the door for strangers."
Yeah, or, you know, since you're...
Or call your, or, you know, hey mom, hey dad, hey Aunt Susie, hey boyfriend's sister, hey neighbor. Hey ex-husband, who loves our children as much as I do. Me and the boyfriend are wanting a getaway. Can you please watch the kids for this week? While we're gone, you can take, if you take them this week, I'll take them on a weekend or on a vacation time when you and your significant other are going to be away."
Yeah, or, you know, since you can afford being bailed out on $5,000, you know, if...
"Kids, why don't we go on a vacation together?"
Yeah, or, you know, again, since you can afford a $5,000 bail, if none of your family or other friends could help you out, get a babysitter.
"Hey, neighbor girl who's 17 years old, here's $1,000. Watch my children."
Yeah.
"While I'm on vacation. Pick them up from school, make sure they're fed, make sure they're clean. When I come back, I'll give you another $500. Bye."
So many ways this could have been avoided, but
so
my God.
Many. So many common sense ways.
This woman's a teacher. This woman is a fucking teacher.
My mother was a middle school teacher for a very long time until she retired. Well, before the school board fucked her over and then she retired.
Yeah.
She would have been livid.
So, when police confronted Kaviaska in December, she admitted spending a weekend in Florida with her boyfriend, but claimed that her brother had stayed with the children.
Why didn't she just actually ask
her brother? Why didn't she actually ask her brother?
Because that would have been intelligent. But you know the thing about children, especially at a young age, despite the fact that some of them are known for lying, when cops show up, they tell the truth.
They hella tell the truth.
They, most of the time anyway, they told cops that they were left home alone, unsupervised, with one of the children saying that only their dog was with them.
At least, thank God, the dog was there!
Kaviaska's son told police that his mother, quote, left snacks to eat, and that she ordered Uber Eats for the children several times. The boy recalled that his mother advised not to go upstairs and to stay in the basement. And that's the end of the article.
Hello, Child Services.
Yes.
Again, I hope their biological dad is a good person who got custody. Biological father is a very good person who got custody of them after this incident, and who now can go straight to the courts going, oh, by the way, you know how I said my ex was a bitch? Here's the proof. Can I have my kids now?
This was in Florida, right, Trey?
No, she went to Florida.
She went to Florida. She's from Connecticut.
Connecticut, not much better. Okay, so one of the big problems I've noticed with the court system, especially the family court system, is that in a lot of the red states, especially back east, no offense, Trade, they're still pretty fucking backwards when it comes to child safety. Right. Back in the day, way back in like the 40s, 50s, and even into the 60s, the courts just kind of favored the mother in these child custody dispute cases. It didn't even matter if there was testimonial from the husband and other witnesses that the mom was actually abusive, unless there was direct incontrovertible evidence of the fact, the courts would usually just give the kids to mom.
Yep.
Because in their eyes, in the eyes of the law, the mother was the more appropriate caregiver.
Yep.
Because backwards ass sexism.
Yeah. Again, sadly, because I have watched so much true crime shit, there has been many a terrible incident that could have been avoided if the actual proper parent had been given the child rather than the one who was clearly shit. Simply because, it's more appropriate because women are natural caregivers.
And a lot of states are reversing this and making it so that the judge has a lot, decides who gets primary care based on the merit. Sadly, a lot of states out east and a lot of states out east that are red, especially, still hold on to these old ideals.
Mm-hmm. Which is bad because, and no offense, Fanny, some women are fucking nuts.
No, I completely agree. I have met and known many women who were terrible mothers who should never have had custody of their children, and yet the court still insisted that the woman needed to have her child because women are natural caregivers, and by instinct, they have to take care of their babies. Even though Dad is saying, my child is living in squalor!
Yeah. Yep.
And come on, Trade. I mean, yeah, the whole, like, some women are nuts. Look at Fanny. She's crazy.
But I know better than to fucking leave a child in the basement!
There's a difference between being crazy and being a fanatic.
There's a difference between being crazy and being an abusive, child-neglecting monster. No,
yes, I know. I just couldn't help getting a rib in at my soul sister there for a second.
But your point is made. There is a difference between a fucking a crazy-ass fanatic, a.k.a. me, and, like, the difference between me and this woman is that I would never leave a child alone by themselves unless they're at the very least 15 years old, and they know better than to fucking throw a party.
Mm-hmm.
Were I a mother, I would not leave my children alone. I would either try and save the fucking money to take them on the vacation with me, or I would actually go to the people in my life who I know can watch my kids and go, hey, here's a whole bunch of money. Watch the kids while we're gone. Or better yet, I just wouldn't fucking take the vacation. I'd just say, hey, kids, let's blow all this money on fucking pizza and Steam games for the next weekend and just have a staycation.
Yeah.
Do you mind if mom's new boyfriend comes up?
If mom's new boyfriend hangs out with us? Yeah, on Sunday, you're going to spend time with your aunt and your uncle or your friends down the street while mom and her boyfriend play some games together.
You're going to...
I'm sure the 11-year-old is just like, ew, mom.
But yeah.
You're gonna love this.
What?
This is not the first time I have ever heard a story like this.
Oh, I'm sure.
Neither have I. I work in the courthouse, man. Are you kidding me?
In fact, I had an engineering company as a client, okay, in the early 90s, okay? And they actually made the news because one of the engineers and his wife left their 9-year-old and their 7-year-old, okay, at home when they flew to Europe.
No, God, that's even worse.
If you can afford a vacation in Europe, hire a nanny.
Yes. It would have gone off without a hitch, they said, except that the kids overflowed the bathtub and caused a water alarm in the house.
So what you're saying is they literally said, we would have gotten away with it too if it weren't for those damn kids.
Exactly. But I was doing technical work for that company, and they're like, just don't talk about it. Don't say anything.
We don't talk about.
We've let these people go, or we've let this engineer go. We don't want to talk about it.
So it's literally course, we don't talk course, about everyone, Bruno.
But of course, like when management wasn't around, we're gonna fucking talk about this.
it was the whole Bruno situation. You know,
we don't talk about Bruno.
We don't talk about Bruno.
I really need to know about Bruno. Yeah.
But that's all we talk about. So yes. But this sort of shit goes on all the time.
Yeah,
and we really wish it didn't.
Moral
and the thing it really bothers me too is that
you know what's even worse? For a few thousand dollars, they could have just sold those kids.
Oh, jeez. Oh.
I was gonna bring up the thing here. It kind of bothers me that there, unfortunately, it's because of events like this that there's no middle ground reaction to helping to like dealing with the kids. I mean, I'm sure Gray remembers this, Fanny probably does, but I definitely remember this. I actually was still a kid when it was still appropriate, still okay, that if it wasn't a super hot day and you left the windows down, you could leave your fucking kids in the car while you went grocery shopping.
Yep.
Nobody thought twice about that. Now you can't do that anymore. You get your ass roasted.
Yep.
If your kid didn't roast alive first.
Well, here's the thing is that... You know, back then, there wasn't air conditioning in the cars, okay, really. It really wasn't a thing.
It wasn't a thing, and your mom wasn't going to leave the engine fucking running and waste gas.
Yes, because gas was fucking expensive at $1.59 a gallon or something annoying. Let's not even go there.
Yeah, but basically, like, roll the windows down. Mom goes in for like 20 minutes, half an hour to go shopping. The kids stay in the car. No one cared.
And
not unless the windows were up and it was like in LA.
Mm-hmm. You know,
or the deep south.
Right, or the deep south, right.
Same thing with animals. You could take a spot with you on a trip to the grocery store, leave spot in the car with the window rolled down long enough for them to get some air, and of course to keep them from suffocating, while you run into the store, pick up the dog food and 6 cases of beer, and then head home.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And they didn't break your car window because your dog was in the car.
Yeah.
In my town, people still do that. I still see dogs left in the car.
Either way.
No one really bats an eye at that. But it's just kind of to this point of like, come on, guys. Like, we need to have a middle ground here. We can't have this, like, super overprotectiveness and then this super neglectfulness and then nothing in between.
Well, until we find that middle ground, the moral of the story here, ladies and gentlemen, is... just hire a fucking babysitter next time.
Like that's the moral of many multiple stories of several stories that we've had tonight. Is either just hire a fucking babysitter, just hire a fucking surrogate. Like the ultimate moral of most of tonight's stories are just hire someone legitimate to do the job.
Mm-hmm.
And don't go fishing with syringes. It doesn't work.
And drugs do not work as fishing bait.
Nope. Ladies and gentlemen.
Tell you what.
Again.
Moving on.
How much for that baby in the window? A lot, apparently.
I think that's going to wrap it up for tonight for this episode of The Train Wreck. Oh, boy. You know, for a week where I actually struggled to find some news articles, we actually had a pretty fun show this week, didn't we?
It's a treasure trove and a cavalcade of absolute disaster.
Just a whole fucking pile.
Just like any other train wreck.
Yeah.
It was indeed a marvelous train wreck.
Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, that is going to be
Reminds me of Silver Streak.
Oh, God.
Oh, Lord. But yeah, that's going to be it for Trademark Train Wreck. With me here tonight has been Random Greymane.
I'm going to go into the basement.
We also had Sherlock.
We're on a train. We don't have a basement.
Don't tell him that. And finally, we had the fangirl with us tonight.
If you get hungry, just eat all the candy and try to stay low so nobody sees you in the window.
Oh, Lordy. Our theme song was created by Marivex, and our banner art was created by Court Awesome. You can find their social media, our social media, and all of the links to all the articles we talked about in the YouTube description. And if you're watching on YouTube, I highly request that you subscribe and all that stuff to the Trademarks Trainwreck YouTube channel.
Because the algorithm is filled of demons and Karens.
Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen.
And women who want to buy babies.
You've been listening to Trademarks Trainwreck, which is a show featured on Celestia Radio, all fandom all the time. My name is Trademark. And good night.
This candy tastes funny.